In today's session, we are going to discuss about the blood and its properties, and also we are going to discuss about the plasma and its proteins. Okay. Hello, hi everyone. Myself Shivani Sharma. Hope you all are doing very well. In today's session, we are going to discuss about the blood and its properties, and also we are going to discuss about the plasma and its proteins. Okay. So first, we start with the blood. What is blood? Is it a connective tissue, or is it a muscle, or is it a organ? So blood fall under the category of fluid connective tissue. Our entire body is made up of four type of tissue: epithelial tissue, connective tissue, muscular tissue, and nervous tissue. Okay, and blood comes in which category? Blood comes in the category of connective tissue. Okay, blood comes in the category of connective tissue. Okay. Connective tissue further have three types. The one is loose connective tissue, the another is dense connective tissue, and the last we have specialized connective tissue. In specialized connective tissue, blood and your cartilage and bones, they all are come. So blood is what? Blood, it is a fluid connective tissue. Blood, it is a fluid connective tissue. Now the next question is, what is the origin of connective tissue? Every cell and every tissue, they have origin. Okay, because when we were in the embryonic development, inner mass is differentiated into the three germ layer, which is ectoderm, endoderm, and the mesoderm. Okay, so the cells or the tissue of the connective tissue, they has been originated from the germ layer of mesoderm. So what is the origin? Origin is your mesoderm. Okay. How much blood we have in our body? The total volume of blood in our body is 5 to 6 liter. Okay. The total volume of blood is 5 to 6 liter. The next point is, what is the pH of blood? Blood is acidic, or neutral, or the alkaline. So blood is your slightly alkaline. Okay, the pH of blood is 7.4 plus minus 0.05. okay, the next is, pH of blood is 7.4 plus minus 0.05. okay, so we have a particular pH meter scale in which we measure the pH of anything. Okay, if the pH is less than 7, then we consider the thing as a acidic. If the pH is above the 7, it is your basic, okay, or alkaline, you can say that. And if the pH around your 7, so then it is your neutral. So what is the pH of blood? pH of blood is 7.4 plus minus 0.05, and it is slightly alkaline. Now the next point is, what are the components are present in the blood? So blood have two components. The one is cellular components, and the another is non-cellular components. Okay, so the blood have what? Blood have two components. Blood have two components. The one is cellular components, and the another is non-cellular components. Okay, how do we know, like, bloods have all these components? Bloods have cellular components and the non-cellular components. Okay, so we take a test tube. Okay, what we do, we take a test tube, and in the test tube we collect the blood. Okay, suppose here we collect the blood. After collecting the blood in a test tube, we keep this blood in a machine, which is your centrifuge. After the process of centrifugation, blood is divided into the two things. One is your cellular components, and the another is your non-cellular component. The amount of the cellular component is 45%, and the amount of non-cellular component is 55%. Okay. In cellular components, they are also known as the PCV, which is your packed cell volume. Okay? Which is your packed cell volume. In cellular components, we have three type of cells. The one is your RBC, red blood cell. The second is your WBC, white blood cells. And the third, we have platelets. Okay? And in the non-cellular components, as their name indicates, they do not have any type of a cell, and it is a straw or yellowish colored material, which is your plasma. So what happened in the process of centrifugation? When we collect the blood in a test tube, okay, after that we kept in a machine, which is your centrifuge, and then we start a process of centrifugation. So blood have cellular component as well as they have non-cellular components. So these cellular components, they are running in entire blood, and this every cells have their different test plate. Yes, jab hum is blood ko centrifuge mein rakhenge, to every cells they rotate with their different speeds. Har cell ki apni different speed hogi, us pe wo rotate karega. Okay, so after that jab hum machine ko band karte to sediment hote hai, so wo settled hone lagte hai. Theek hai, so jo aapki RBC and platelets hote hai, they settle down at the bottom. Okay, so isme aapke kya aa gaye, RBC and platelets, which is known as the PCV, packed cell volume. Okay, and jinki speed kam hoti hai wo upper surface pe they float, which is your plasma. And now talk about the WBC. WBC have less speed as comparison to the RBC and the platelets. So they make a whitish color buffy coat here. Okay, wo yahan par ek whitish color ka buffy coat banate hain. So this is what? This is the buffy coat. And in less than 1% of buffy coat, your WBC are present. Okay? So the packed cell volume is determined by the your RBC and the platelets. Okay? Packed this PCV volume is also affected in some medical condition. We know that the PCV value is 45%. When somebody have any kind of medical condition, for example, the spherocytosis. Okay, if somebody have condition like spherocytosis, so this PCV volume increases. This packed cell volume is increases. Why? Because normally, what is the shape of RBC? The RBC shape is biconcave. But in the case of spherocytosis, RBC become more spherical. What happened? RBC become more spherical. Suppose RBC become like this. Okay, now they occupy the maximum area, which increase the packed cell volume. Okay, so this is not necessary every time packed cell volume is fixed only. Okay, they also affect in some medical condition. Okay, see it. So what happened in spherocytosis? In spherocytosis, our PCV volume is increases. Okay, and here the RBC cells becomes the more spherical. Now if we talk about the functions of blood, what are the functions of blood? For blood have what? Blood have this plasma and the cellular components. Okay, what is the function of RBC? RBC contain a pigment, which is the hemoglobin. Okay, and the color of hemoglobin is red, and RBC are present in maximum number as comparison to the other of two cell. That's why the color of blood is your red. Okay, and the second thing, this hemoglobin pigment, it is the carrier for the gases. It is the carrier for the gases like your oxygen and the carbon dioxide. So RBC play a very important role in the transportation of oxygen as well as of the carbon dioxide. Next to WBC, you know that WBC, they are known as the soldiers of the body, because when during the time of infection, when pathogen enters in our body, this WBC makes antibodies and kill the pathogen. So they provides what? They provides the immunity. Platelets secrete some platelet derived growth factor, which is very important for the clotting. If you have injury, after the injury, the blood will come out of the tissue, okay? But after the some 2 to 3 minute time, it will stop. The bleeding will be stopped. Why? Because the platelet, they secrete the derived growth factor and make us come over the skin, which prevents the bleeding, okay? And the make a coagulation here, okay? In our particular lecture, we will discuss about the in detail about the mechanism of coagulation. Next, we know that the plasma have what? In plasma we have 91% water. In the plasma we have 91% water and the 9% other substances are present. 9% other substances are present and 91% water is present, okay? In 9% other substances, your inorganic and the organic substance are present. In 9% we have some inorganic substances and we have some organic substances, okay? In inorganic substances like your bicarbonate ions, your ferric ions, ferrous ions, okay, sodium, potassium, these all are present. Next, in the organic matters, proteins and other substances are present, okay? Plasma proteins and other substances like fat, vitamins, glucose, neurotransmitters, excretory waste like urea, present. Okay? So plasma have what? Plasma contains the 91% water and 9% other substances. And in other substances, there is a two type of composition you found. The one is inorganic and the another is your organic. In inorganic, like your sodium, potassium, bicarbonate ions, your ferric ions, your magnesium, these all are present. In organic substances, plasma proteins are present and the other substances like fat, vitamins, excretory waste, urea. Because after the digestion, when your body digests the food, okay, so this digested food goes where? It is goes in your blood, okay, and they transport it with the help of blood in each and every cell, okay. What are the types of plasma proteins? There are four types of plasma proteins. The one is albumin, the second is globulin, the next is your fibrinogen, and the next is your prothrombin. In albumin, globulin and fibrinogen and prothrombin, albumin have a major amount, and albumin is the most abundant plasma protein. And the volume of albumin protein is 55%. Albumin play a very important role in the transportation of thyroxine hormone and the erythropoietin hormone, okay? This globulin plays a very important role in forming the antibodies, and this fibrinogen and the prothrombin, these are inactive proteins and they are responsible for the blood clotting. They play a very, very important role in coagulation mechanism, okay? And these are the inactive proteins, okay? And they are responsible for the blood clotting. Now, AG ratio is very important. AG ratio is very important. What is your AG ratio? AG ratio is 1.7:1. In some medical conditions, okay, a person have any medical condition or any kind of disorder, so this AG ratio can increases as well as they decreases. Okay, what is the normal AG ratio? The normal AG ratio is 1.7:1. Okay, but in some medical condition, this AG ratio can also affect. Okay, in detail, we discuss about the plasma protein. First, we are talked about the RBC. RBCs are what? RBC means red blood cells, or cells are also, you can use the terminology corpuscles for use instead of using the cell. Okay, RBC are also known as the erythrocyte, and they are also known as the red blood corpuscle. As I told you, RBC is present in the maximum number. Okay, so RBC have 5 to 5.5 million of RBC per mm cube of blood. Okay, RBCs have biconcave in shape. RBCs have shape like biconcave. Okay, and also on the surface of the RBC membrane, the cell membrane of RBC is known as the glycocalyx. Okay, and on the surface of the RBC, some glycoproteins are present. Okay, these are what? These are the glycoprotein. What is the meaning of glycoprotein? Here the protein is conjugated with the carbohydrate. Okay, and these glycoproteins are nothing, these are the antigen. These are what? These are the antigen. RBCs, they do not have nucleus and the mitochondria, because RBC contain a very important pigment, which is the HB. You can see in RBC, nucleus and mitochondria is not present. So at the center, you found a hollow space, which is known as the central pallor, which is known as the central pallor. And in the central pallor region, hemoglobin is present. Okay, if RBC do not contain the mitochondria, so which type of respiration take place in the RBC? Very important. RBC have anaerobic type of respiration. Why? Because aerobic respiration take place in mitochondria, but they do not contain the mitochondria. So in cytoplasm, anaerobic respiration take place. Okay, so RBC respires how? RBC respires anaerobically, because anaerobic respiration take place in the cytoplasm. Next, they have a red colored iron containing complex protein, which is known as the hemoglobin. A healthy individual has 12 to 16 gram of hemoglobin in every 100 ml of blood. Okay, if somebody have less than this amount, so they suffer from the anemia. Anemia means loss of hemoglobin. RBC have an average lifespan of about 120 days. After the completing of lifespan, they die in the spleen. Where the spleen is present? Suppose this is the stomach. Behind the stomach, spleen is present. Okay, when they complete their lifespan, so RBC died in the spleen. That's why spleen is also known as the graveyard of RBC. Okay, the next we have process, which is the erythropoiesis. What is erythropoiesis? Erythropoiesis means formation of RBC. Means the process of formation of red blood cells, this is known as the erythropoiesis. Okay, I'm telling you one mnemonic, because when we were in the embryonic development, this process take place in the different area. For that we have mnemonic, which is your young liver synthesize blood. Young liver synthesize the blood. When we were in the embryonic development in our mother's womb, so this erythropoiesis take place in the yolk sac. Y for young and Y for your yolk sac. Okay, what is yolk sac? These are the extra embryonic membrane. Okay, yolk sac and the allantois, these are the extra embryonic membrane. Okay, and next, this during the embryonic development, initially erythropoiesis formation take place in the yolk sac. After that, it take place in the liver. After that, it take place in the explain. See, when you are in the embryonic development, this process takes place in the spleen. But when you will mature after that, this is the place for the RBC death. Okay, here the RBC, they died here. Okay, next, after that spleen, when fully fetus is matured inside the mother's womb, when formation of the fetus completely take place, and after that this process take place in the bone marrow. Okay, जब बच्चे एम्ब्रियोनिक डेवलपमेंट में होता है एंड फीटस पूरा बन जाता है, आफ्टर दैट दिस प्रोसेस टेक प्लेस इन दी बोन मैरो. ओके, सपोज दिस इज दी बोन. ओके, दिस पार्ट ऑफ दी बोन इज एपिफाइसिस विच इज सॉफ्ट एंड स्पंजी, एंड इन दिस पार्ट रेड बोन मैरो इज प्रेजेंट, एंड इन दिस पार्ट रेड बोन मैरो इज प्रेजेंट. ओके, and this is the long and shafted part of a bone which is known as the diaphysis, and in the diaphysis part yellow bone marrow is present. So in red bone marrow, hematopoietic stem cells are present which can be converted into the any type of blood cells. Basically, this hematopoietic stem cells are responsible for the hemopoiesis. Okay, they are responsible for what? Suppose these are the hematopoietic cells and they are responsible for the process of hemopoiesis. What is hemopoiesis? Hemopoiesis means formation of blood. Okay, hemopoiesis means formation of blood. Okay, because as I told you, these hematopoietic stem cells, they can be converted into the any type of the blood cells. Now this hematopoietic stem cells, if they converted into the RBC, what happened? Suppose this hematopoietic stem cell converted into the proerythroblast. They can convert it into the proerythroblast. What is this proerythroblast? Blast word we are using for the immature cells. And since this is the proerythroblast, means this is the immature RBC. Okay. After the maturation of proerythroblast, it got converted into the mature erythrocyte. Okay. It got converted into the erythrocyte. And erythrocyte is known as the RBC. Erythrocyte is also known as the RBC. So what things are responsible for the maturation of RBC? So that is your vitamin B12 and the folic acid. Vitamin B12 and folic acid play a very important role in the maturation of immature RBC. That's why when somebody have a deficiency of a folic acid or the vitamin B12 in body, so they suffer from the anemia like condition. Okay, what happened? In red bone marrow, hematopoietic stem cells are present. Now this cell got converted into the RBC. So for that, initially what happened? This hematopoietic stem cell got converted into the proerythroblast. This is immature RBC. Now this immature RBC goes under the maturation, and what things are responsible for the maturation of RBC? Folic acids and the vitamin B12. When the RBC got matured, they lost their nucleus and the mitochondria. During the time of the process of maturation, this proerythroblast lost the nucleus and the mitochondria. Why they lost these two things? Because in pure RBC, hemoglobin is present. Okay, for making space for the hemoglobin pigment, they lost the nucleus and the mitochondria. Is it okay? Next we have WBC. WBC are also known as the white blood cells, and they are also known as the leukocytes. Okay, WBC are also known as the white blood cells, or you can use the terms corpuscle. Okay, and they are also known as the leukocyte. Now they are WBC, they are colorless because they are not containing any kind of the hemoglobin pigment. RBC do not have nucleus, but WBC have nucleus, they are the nucleated. As comparison to the RBC, they have a low amount, 6000 to 8000 mm per cube of the blood. Leukocytes, they are generally short-lived and their lifespan is not particularly determined because every WBC have different lifespan. The next, they are of two types. We categorized the WBC into the two categories. The one is your granulocytes and the another is your agranulocytes. We have two type of WBC, granulocytes WBC and the next is agranulocytes WBC. Granulocyte means in this type of WBC granules are present. Suppose this is a WBC and in this WBC small proteins are present, which is known as the granules. These granules are nothing, these are the proteins only, okay? So those WBC which contains the granules, they are known as the granulocyte. Example is eosinophil, basophil and the neutrophil. Next come talk about the agranulocyte, means WBC do not contains the granules. Example is your lymphocyte and the monocyte. Okay. Further, lymphocyte have two type. The one is your B lymphocyte, or you can say that the B cell lymphocyte or the T cell lymphocyte. Okay. And there's one interesting property about the WBC, which is what? WBC can show the movement. Yes, WBC moves in your blood and this movement is known as the amoeboid movement, okay? Like amoeba makes a false feet, na? And with the help of the false feet, amoeba moves from one position to the another position. Similarly, how this WBC travels in our blood? By the help of the amoeboid movement. Amoeba ki jaisi false feet banayega and blood mein ek jagah se dusri jagah ghoomta hai. WBC shows the movement and which type of movement shows by the WBC? This is the amoeboid movement. And this amoeboid movement, how they show the amoeboid movement? By making the pseudopodia. Okay, by making what? By making the pseudopodia. Pseudo word we are using for the false and podia word we are using for the feet. Okay, like this. They make the false feet like this and moves from in the blood. Okay, travel in the blood. And this movement is known as the amoeboid movement. And they also show the one type of movement. Yes, suppose this is your blood vessels. And in your blood vessels, WBCs are moving. These are your WBCs. Okay. And suppose here you have a tissue. Okay. This is the tissue. When in your tissue, pathogen enters. Suppose this is the pathogen. When in your tissue, pathogen enters. So how this pathogen kills? By the WBC. So how the WBC kills this pathogen? So now the WBC makes a jump in your tissues and this movement is known as the diapedesis movement, okay? When WBC moves from blood to the tissues. Now WBC makes a false feet. Now it makes a pseudopodia and come into the, where? Come into the tissue. And with the help of the phagocytosis action, they engulf the pathogen, okay? So this movement is known as the diapedesis, okay? This movement is known as the diapedesis movement. What is diapedesis movement? When WBC moves from blood to tissue. When WBC moves from blood to the tissue, this type of movement is known as the diapedesis movement, okay? This is important. And the next, which cells are responsible for doing the diapedesis type of movement? which is your neutrophil and the monocyte. Okay, next we have a different type of WBC. How we differentiated the WBC in such categories? The first is by the presence of granules, and the secondary is by the morphology of nucleus. Okay, by the morphology of what? By the morphology of nucleus. So we know that I'm making here a table. The first we have lymphocyte, then we have monocyte. In this site, we are writing about the features, and then we will discuss about the features of different type of WBC. Eosinophil, okay. Next is your basophil, and the next we have neutrophil. Okay, so on this side we are writing about the feature. The first feature we have the presence of granules. Okay, the presence of what? The presence of the granules. Okay, you know that lymphocyte and monocytes come under the category of agranulocyte. So definitely they do not contain the granules. But this eosinophil, basophils and the neutrophils, they all have what? They all have the granules. Now talk about the percentage. Now talk about the volume of lymphocyte, monocytes. So these lymphocytes, they are 20 to 25%, and this monocyte, they are 6 to 8%, and eosinophil, their amount is 2 to 3%. Basophils, they are about 1% or less than 1%. Okay, next. Okay, this is 1%, and the amount of neutrophil is 60 to 65%. They are present in maximum amount. Okay, so the amount of lymphocyte 20 to 25%, monocyte 6 to 8%, eosinophil 2 to 3%, and basophil 1%, and the neutrophil, they are present in maximum number, which is your 60 to 65%. As I told you, they have a different type of nucleus. On the basis of morphology of nucleus, we divided into the such categories. Okay, for now we are going to talk about the morphology of nucleus. Morphology of nucleus. In the morphology of nucleus, lymphocytes have a round type of nucleus. Okay, what they have? Suppose lymphocytes have what? Lymphocytes have round type of nucleus. Next, talk about the monocytes. Monocytes have bean shaped nucleus. Monocytes have bean shaped nucleus. Eosinophils have bilobed nucleus. Eosinophils, there are two lobes present in the nucleus, just like the headphones. Headphones, देखे ना आप जो कानों पे लगाते हो वही. Eosinophils have bilobed nucleus, like this. They have bilobed nucleus. This is bean-shaped nucleus, and this is round-shaped nucleus. Next, basophil. Basophil have trilobed nucleus. Three lobes hoti hai, and their appearance is S-shaped. Okay, 1, 2, and 3. They have trilobed nucleus. And this neutrophil have PMNL type of nucleus. Many nucleus are present. Okay, like the group of nucleus like this present. And this type of nucleus is known as CPMNL. What is the full form of PMNL? Polymorphonucleocyte. Polymorphonucleocyte. Okay. And these cells are what? These are the cells which have granules. So just draw the granules. Okay. So they contains what? These are the granules. Because these are the granulocytes, WBC. Now talk about the functions of the lymphocytes. Okay. Next feature we have functions. So lymphocytes have two types. Lymphocytes are of your two type na. The one is your B cell and the another is your T cell. This B cells provides the humoral immunity. Humoral immunity means this B cells makes antibodies in our body. Okay. This B cells produce antibodies in our body. And those cells which produced the antibodies in our body, so they are providing the humoral immunity. So they are providing what? They are providing the humoral immunity. Next is T cells. T cells are provided the cell mediated immunity. T cells are provided what? They are provided the cell mediated immunity. These T cells are responsible for kill the cancer cells and for they are responsible for the graft rejection. These T cells are responsible for the graft rejection and they also kill the cancer cells. So here these cells are directly involved to kill the any foreign cell. So this type of immunity is known as the cell mediated immunity. Okay. So this are these they are providing what? They are providing the cell mediated immunity. Now talk about the monocyte. What is the function of monocyte in our body? These are the phagocytic cells. These are the phagocytic cells. As I told you, when we have a pathogen infection in our body, so they travels from blood to the tissue. Okay. The next we have eosinophil. Eosinophils, they are the anti-parasites. They are what? They are the anti-parasite. Okay. Means when we have any helminthic infection in our body, helminthic infection like when somebody have an infection with ascaris or the tapeworm or any cases. Okay. So that time this, they produce the antibodies and they kill the parasite. Okay. So that's why they are known as the anti-parasites. And next, this basophil, they are responsible for the inflammation and they are secreted the three things. Okay. When we have any infection, so during the time of any infection, inflammation or swelling happens. Now, why? Because of this basophils, which activates the WBC. And they also secretes three things. The one is your histamine. Next is your heparin. And the next is your serotonin. What is the function of histamine? Histamine are responsible for the vasodilation. They dilate the blood vessels. Vaso word always associate vasa word with your blood vessels. Heparin is anticoagulant, which prevents from the clotting. Okay, which stops the clotting. It is anticoagulant. Next is serotonin, which is the vasoconstriction, which constrict the blood vessels. Next, these neutrophils, they are present in the maximum amount and these are the first one which arrive at the site of infection because they are present in maximum number and they have another property which is your phagocytic and they arrive first at the site of At the site of infection. The next we have platelets. The next topic we have platelets. Platelets are also known as the thrombocyte. Whenever you see the terminology thrombo, thrombo means coagulation. They are responsible for the coagulation, okay? They are formed where, I told you, every blood cells, they formed in the red bone marrow. So definitely they are also formed in the red bone marrow. Platelets, they are formed in the red bone marrow. And secondary, what is the amount of platelets in our body? So the amounts of normal platelet is 1.5 lakh to 3.5 lakh. 1.5 lakh to 3.5 lakh per mm cube of blood. Okay, per mm cube of blood. Next, this is the total amount of blood. Okay, this is the total amount of platelets which is present in our body. During the time of dengue, platelet count got decreases, okay, which result to the internal bleeding or the hemorrhage like condition in a person body. Because platelets, they are responsible for the clotting, they are responsible for the blood coagulation. But during the time of the dengue infection, during the time of this infection, the platelets count got decreases, okay? And they are about 5 to 10,000 only. Agar bahut critical situation ho, to us time mein patient mein internal bleeding ke conditions bahut zyada badh jati hai. Because to ye virus hota hai, ye virus kis pe attack karta hai? Ye platelets pe attack karta hai, unke count ko kam karta hai, okay? As I told you, these cells, they are formed where? They are formed in the red bone marrow. So in red bone marrow, megakaryocyte cell is present. What is the meaning of megakaryocyte cell? Suppose this is the cell. The size of the nucleus is so big, that's why it is known as the megakaryocyte cell. Basically, platelets are what? Platelets are the fragments of cells, okay? Platelets are what? Platelets are nothing. These are the fragments of cell. Why? Because in red bone marrow, okay, megakaryocyte cell were formed. After the disintegration in megakaryocyte, they converted into the fragment of cell which is known as the platelets. So kya tukde hai cells ke. And the what is the shape of platelets? They are biconvex in shape. And what is the function of platelets? They help in blood clotting. Okay? They help in blood clotting. How? By secreting platelet derived growth factor. Okay, so that's it for the today. The rest of the things we will discuss in our next session. Okay, in our next session we will going to talk about the plasma proteins and the disease which is related to the plasma protein. These all things we will going to discuss in our next session, and also we will going to discuss about the mechanism of coagulation. Okay, till then take care. Bye. Thank you.